Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 12801 in the name of Michelle Thompson on Taliban suppression of women's and girls' rights in Afghanistan. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I invite Michelle Thompson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I say thank you to colleagues who stayed for this debate as well, at an untypical time after decision time on a Thursday. So on to the serious matters, and Presiding Officer, let me start by saying, if you've been raped in Afghanistan, don't report it. You'll be accused of adultery and face public flogging or even stoning to death. If you're a woman or a young girl and need the protection of international human rights, don't live in Afghanistan where every right has been trashed. If you're a girl over the age of 13, you are now denied the right to a school or university education. And if you're a women's rights activist, you face the wrath of the Taliban. According to Genocide Today in their publication of December 2023, and I quote, the Taliban have arrested many women's rights activists such as Julia Parsi. These women were in the front lines fighting against inequalities. Today, they are tortured and raped by the Taliban. Tortured and raped for daring to promote the rights of women. So it is for the Julia Parsis and the oppressed women of Afghanistan that I dedicate this speech. Now, members of this Parliament will know I frequently raise concerns about the rights and needs of women in Scotland. But we cannot just believe in the rights of women at home. International human rights cannot just be for the affluent West. Now, I cannot claim first-hand knowledge of what life for the women of Afghanistan is like. But I know they need their voice to be heard and acted upon. And I know the international community has not stood with the women of Afghanistan as they should. So let me remind members of the context. I give thanks to David Lloyd Webber, the UK Managing Director of the Human Emergency Response NGO, Emergency, for much of the following detail. Afghanistan's been affected by violent conflict for over 40 years. Since the 2021 Taliban's takeover, the humanitarian crisis has deepened, an inheritance of the long war, poverty and corruption. The already weak institutions have faced the impact of natural disasters, resulting in a fragile social fabric. International sanctions and the freeze of Afghanistan's international assets abroad have put an extreme strain on a country that relied on international aid for 75% of public finance prior to the latest Taliban takeover. It is the work of NGOs such as Emergency that are critical in the provision of health services for women and children. Despite the heroic efforts of many, by 2022, 10.8 million Afghans lacked access to basic primary healthcare services. As of October 2022, 4.7 million children and pregnant and lactating women were estimated to be at risk of acute malnutrition. For women, being separated, widowed or divorced are linked to a decreasing ability to access care because of Taliban rule. Now, amidst this situation, imagine you are a young girl or woman. You're now denied the right to attend school or university, denied the right to work in most sectors of the economy and society. But those few areas you are allowed to work in, such as healthcare, you can no longer be given the educational opportunities to realistically aspire to become a nurse, a doctor, or any profession allied to the health sector. Nor, since more recent decrees, are you allowed to work in the wider NGO sector that provides critical support for women and children. If you need to travel any distance from home, you're expected to be accompanied by a mahram, a male chaperone. If you do venture from your home alone and unaccompanied, you run the risk of being harassed or beaten by the Taliban's so-called morality police. Since the takeover, they've introduced not one, but 50 decrees that directly curtail the rights and dignity of women. This is a systematic attack on the rights of every girl and woman. And as a United Nations report pointed out earlier this year, and I quote, "The Taliban's vision for Afghanistan is founded on a structural denial of women's rights, well-being and personhood." Samira Hamidi, an Afghan activist at Amnesty International, has pointed out, in the past 2.5 years, the Taliban has dismantled institutions that were providing services to Afghan women. Last year, the Taliban's deputy in the Supreme Court said that the court has issued 37 sentences of stoning and 4 people were buried alive in a wall. But the situation is getting worse with further growth of violence against women. Habibullah Akhundzada, the Taliban's supreme leader, in setting out the ways women can be punished in an audio message broadcast on March 24th of this year, stated, "We will flog the women. We will stone them to death in public." What a flagrant violation of international human rights laws, including the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. As Safia Arefi, head of Afghan human rights organisation Women's Window of Hope, said, "With this announcement by the Taliban leader, a new chapter of private punishments has begun." She went on to say, "Now no one standing beside them can save them from Taliban punishments. The international community has chosen to remain silent in the face of these violations of women's rights. I will not remain silent. I ask this Parliament not to do so either." Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. We now move to the open debate. I call first Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Pam Gosal. Around 4 minutes, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I shall read from my iPhone, on the grounds that I'm incredibly short-sighted and unable to read the notes that I normally bring to such debates because I left them in my office. So apologies for that. But I wish to thank my colleague Michelle Thompson for securing crucial debating time on this very important subject. Since the Taliban's drawn to power in Afghanistan in August 2021, they've enforced stringent gender policies, citing Sharia law and traditional Afghan customs as a justification for the appalling measures they've imposed on Afghan women and girls. Just a short list of these draconian decrees includes forbidding women to work outside the home, requiring to wear head-to-toe coverings when they leave, preventing them from doing so without a male relative, and using captured women from Afghanistan's internal wars as slaves and concubines. The gravity of the situation has been underscored by the United Nations Security Council, which stressed that the Taliban's actions amount to gender persecution and may indeed represent a crime against humanity under the Rome Statute, to which Afghanistan has been a party since 2003. The ramifications of these policies are far-reaching and devastating. Afghan women experience the lowest life expectancy and literacy rates in Asia, the highest infant mortality rates in Asia, and vast increases in prostitution have occurred, along with begging, and these and many other challenges now face the women and girls of Afghanistan. Stereotypical and two-dimensional depictions of Afghanistan often obscure the fact that lives of Afghan women were once very different. Women received the right to vote in 1919, a year after the United Kingdom and a year before the United States. And as early as the 1960s, the Afghan constitution enshrined women's rights under the law. Despite various setbacks, there was a mood of tolerance and openness in the country as it moved towards democracy in the late 20th century. In 1977, women comprised over 15% of Afghanistan's highest legislative body, and by the 1990s, 70% of educators, half of government workers and 40% of doctors in Kabul were women. Indeed, way back in the 1960s, as one woman quoted, "I remember as a girl seeing my mother wearing miniskirts and taking her to the cinema, and my aunt went to university." As I briefly touched upon, the experiences of women under the Taliban represent one of the most egregious human rights abuses in recent memory, and also shows that progress is not always linear in any society. There's no doubt the Scottish Government and international community must continue assisting Afghan women in their battle for liberation and equality. However, it's important to note Afghan women are not inert, helpless victims. Despite facing immense challenges, they continue to demonstrate bravery and resilience that would intimidate even the most formidable foe. As renowned women's rights activists were exiled in the wake of the Taliban's ascent, a new generation of women, younger and from poorer backgrounds, rose to form the Bread, Work, Freedom movement. In the face of tear gas, electric shocks, sexual assault, bullets and arrest, they most recently took to the streets on the 19th of July last year to protest the outlawing of beauty salons. Meanwhile, Afghan educator Pashtana Durrani has created a web of underground schools from exile aimed at educating girls beyond the age of 11. Learn Afghanistan offers courses conducted online, with many taking place in rooms with computers hooked up to generators, all in secret locations to defy the Taliban and avoid detection. Moreover, prominent Afghan women now in exile, such as Friza Rezaia, Afghanistan's first female Olympian, and Shakira Barakazai, a former politician ambassador, use their platforms to raise awareness and garner international support for Afghan women's rights. Furthermore, the work of Dr. Ross Sheriff emphasises the ways ordinary women resist the Taliban in everyday life. Women not only have to fend for themselves, but often they have to fear for their husbands and sons, also under constant risk of imprisonment and execution. Presiding officer, research indicates women play an important role in hiding their male relatives from Taliban soldiers and work all kinds of jobs in the place of exile and indeed in Afghanistan itself to support extended families. When fleeing persecution, women contribute on a decision-making level and maintain contact with other family members to optimise survival efforts. The plight of Afghan women under Taliban rule demands urgent attention and action. While facing grave challenges, they exhibit remarkable resilience and courage. It's essential that we all stand in solidarity, amplify their voices and provide, wherever possible, tangible support. By working together, we can strive towards a future where Afghan women are empowered, respected and free from oppression. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. I now call Pam Gosal to be followed by Ruth Maguire. Around 4 minutes, Ms Gosal.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First, let me thank Michelle Thompson for bringing this crucial issue to the Chamber. I also want to extend my heartfelt thanks to the NGOs and organisations in the United Kingdom and around the world working to raise awareness and pressing governments to take meaningful action for the women and girls of Afghanistan. While I'm honoured to be speaking today on this business motion, I can't help but feel a sense of sadness. As one of my first speeches on this topic in this chamber was in September 2021, one of the things I said was, let us not forget that this is not the end. It is the beginning. The question that we must attend to is what comes next. Unfortunately, what has come next has been much worse, as the Taliban has turned the country back into the dark ages. Here in the United Kingdom, we are so fortunate, and most of the time we take our freedoms for granted. However, this is not the case for the women and girls of Afghanistan. Can you imagine? You can't go to school. You can't work. You can't leave your house on your own. You're forced into a marriage you don't want. Basically, you are a prisoner in your own country. In Afghanistan, most girls are now barred from attending secondary school, and women are basically forbidden from working. When accessing public spaces, they must be accompanied by a male relative. Survivors of sexual violence find no solace as the support systems built over the past 20 years have crumbled into dust. The number of young girls forced into unwanted marriages has skyrocketed as families marry them off to avoid starvation or even to secure protection from Taliban fighters. In the past month, Afghanistan has been affected by catastrophic flooding. According to the Glasgow Afghan United Organisation, this has led at least 70 women being denied their rights and dignity, even in death. This is because the Taliban got rid of all the women workers and would care for the women workers that would care for their bodies and prepare them for this burial. Presiding Officer, we live in the 21st century. This should not be happening. In my maiden speech, I highlighted that as a woman of colour, I had to earn respect in a male-dominating world, especially in my teenage years when my father passed away. I was always told by the so-called man's world and backward traditions a woman could not only do, could only do certain things. I was lucky I live in Britain, a democratic free speech society, where I got the chance to challenge these misogynistic views. Today, I'm in a position that I can openly speak about being a strong advocate for women and girls. Sadly, this we all know is not the case for women and girls of Afghanistan. We all have a duty to do much more, and bringing this discussion to Parliament shows that we haven't forgotten. Since April 2021, the United Kingdom Government has allocated over £600 million in aid, and while it has also established two key resettlement schemes leading to nearly 26,000 Afghans finding refuge here. However, more needs to be done, and this can only happen if we all work together. In closing, Presiding Officer, I stand in unwavering solidarity with all these suffering, all these women and girls suffering in Afghanistan, particularly the women and girls that live, their lives are shattered. I hope that we all one day see an Afghanistan that is free, where women are no longer treated as second-class citizens, but are empowered to pursue their dreams and live in dignity.
Thank you, Ms. Gosnell. I now call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Maguire.
Presiding Officer, at this present time, we don't have to look too hard to see egregious human rights abuses being perpetrated against women and girls, and in the case of Gaza, even babies documented. Stark, shocking, heartbreaking images I hope I never become inured to. And while it may be less present in the media, the context of Afghanistan continues to be categorised by constant prohibitions and restrictions on the rights of women and girls. I'm very grateful to Michelle Thompson for securing cross-party support and bringing this important debate to the Chamber. And I thank her for her long-standing and continuing commitment to women and girls, demonstrated weekly in this Parliament and beyond, and reflected well in her excellent speech. Presiding Officer, I'm a parliamentary member of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. I agree with them as they urge all states to take concrete actions to hold the Taliban accountable for systematic gender-based violations and to condemn it for what it clearly is, gender apartheid. Their recent statement on Afghanistan provides chilling reading. Women are arbitrarily arrested on the streets for allegedly not dressing appropriately and being illegally detained, often without information on their whereabouts provided to family members. There are reports of financial extortion of families in exchange for information about their female relatives' whereabouts. Detained women are subjected to sexual violence by the Taliban. There were a few pockets of life that Afghan women and girls had found to resist, including through remote schooling and operating businesses from home. These too are being violently cracked down upon by the Taliban. Women leaders of civil society organisations, including in the humanitarian sector, continue to be harassed, arrested, listed by the Taliban intelligence services, and forced to resign. The rule of law and the justice system have been obliterated by the Taliban, leaving women and girls nowhere to turn in the face of myriad violations and living in constant fear of punishment due to the unpredictable enforcement of Taliban rules. The UN Special Rapporteur on Afghanistan has noted the institutionalised, systematic and widespread nature of the level of discrimination justifies framing it as gender apartheid. The situation in Afghanistan is setting a very dangerous precedent for women's and girls' rights globally. The Taliban regime must not be legitimised or normalised, and any engagement with the de facto authorities, must put human rights front and centre and be fully informed by the recommendations of Afghan female activists. As Kenneth Gibson set out in his speech, with the historical context of women's place in Afghan society, rights once won are not guaranteed forever. The UN Special Rapporteur has stated, the weight of history offers little indication that the Taliban leadership is willing to embrace human rights. I join the Women's International League for Press, the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom in calling on all states that genuinely stand for the rights of women and girls and justice to take concrete actions to hold the Taliban accountable for these systematic violations. Supporting efforts by the International Criminal Court in prosecuting the crime of gender persecution, in exercising universal jurisdiction regarding gender-based crimes, and issuing arrest warrants and travel bans against the Taliban leadership. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Maguire. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Ben McPherson in around 4 minutes. Mr. Whitfield.
I am very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I extend my thanks to Michelle Thompson for securing this particularly important debate. And it is a privilege as a man to contribute to this and to hear the stories, to hear the explanation, the reach out that's been done by charities and third sector with regard to what's happening within Taliban. Can I also thank Michelle Thompson for her wording of her motion, because I think that in itself is an incredibly powerful statement as to what is happening in a country that is not so far away. And I was very much taken by the phrase that she's lifted from the United Nations that have declared the Taliban and their restriction with regard to the rights of women so gravely that it is the most repressive country in the world. And it is for the rest of the world to look to that and to do something about it. It is for the rest of the world and the men of the rest of the world to look round and say what is happening in Afghanistan is wrong. To Kenneth Gibson's very powerful speech on the history of it and the fact that we go back to 1990 and the power of giving the vote, to Pam Gosal's very strong contribution about taking freedom for granted, which I will come back to at the end, and to Ruth Maguire, who it is always a pleasure to follow in debates because of her powerful and thoughtful contributions. My short contribution, I would like to concentrate on just one element of this, and that is not to take away from any of the very, very powerful stories that we have heard. But it is about the loss of education for girls in Afghanistan and to the role that the BBC World Service is playing, an institution that goes back to 1932 when it launched, and the fact that it has launched, in essence, an education service for the secret schools that we've secret schools, the secret classrooms, the secret groupings of women and girls who come together, and the desire to learn, no matter how horrendous, no matter how horrible people are towards girls in particular, they want to learn. And the history of the world tells us that girls will go to extraordinary lengths to learn. And it is good to see that a series operated by now BBC female journalists who themselves have fled from Kabul for more than 2 years ago now allows a touch of education. And I was incredibly taken by the contribution of a 16-year-old, Amina, who said that, of course, she hasn't set foot in a classroom for 2 years and that she missed the simple routine of being in a school. She missed the routine of classes where she could learn and now spends her day learning to cook traditional Afghan dishes with her mother. Her friend told her about Dars learning and she now watches it and it gives her a small amount of control over her life. Because maybe that's the most powerful thing about education. It returns control, no matter what other people think. This 16-year-old feels a small amount of control. And that is itself an incredibly powerful light that we should look to, we should work to, we should support, we should elevate. And to go back to Pam Gosal's contribution where she talked about taking freedom for granted, wouldn't it be lovely if within this parliament, within the very near future, that taking freedom for granted is a pleasure that the girls and women of Afghanistan could again feel, or at least see the hope that it will come again. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. We now come to the final speaker in the open debate, Ben McPherson. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like colleagues, I pay tribute to Michelle Thompson for bringing this motion to Parliament on this very important issue, and also for her words and the words of all colleagues. For us to discuss it in our Parliament is symbolic of the context that others have referred to, that we are able to speak in this democratic place about these issues, about the fragility of democracy, the importance of international human rights, and how they can be so vulnerable. Because just a few years ago, as Amnesty International have stated, there were around 2 million girls in secondary schools and thousands of female students were pursuing higher education in different fields in Afghanistan. Women were working as doctors, teachers, pilots, athletes, actresses, politicians, diplomats, ministers, deputy ministers, directors, provincial governors, defence lawyers, judges, businesswomen, CEOs and employees of NGOs. The constitution of Afghanistan was one of the most progressive constitutions in the South Asia region, and Afghanistan was showing progress when reporting on human rights treaties implementation before UN treaty bodies. The government institutions such as the Ministry of Women Affairs, Upper House and Lower Houses of Parliament, Independent Human Rights Commission, as well as the Prosecution Office for the Elimination of Violence Against Women and the Special Courts of Elimination of Violence Against Women, were successful in addressing the challenges women face in Afghanistan to some extent. However, just a few years ago, the return of the Taliban on the 15th of August 2021 took all of this away for Afghan women and girls. It was taken away by men. When the Taliban regained control of Afghanistan at that time, their intent to suffocate the rights of women and girls became immediately apparent. And others have spoken about the restrictions on freedom, about Afghanistan becoming, tragically, one of the most repressive countries in the world, the most repressive countries in the world, and the imposition of just horrendous repression and to the extent of the reimposition of stoning to death. It's hard to imagine just how horrific the situation is. Just as the suppression was swiftly implemented by the Taliban in 2021, protests by women also began just as quickly, as Human Rights Watch reported. They took to the streets with placards and chants. Their chants coalesced into a clear demand: bread, work, freedom. And inspirationally, small groups of Afghan women have continued to do this and do this to this day. Indeed, in this spring, women gathered in private spaces to demand that harsh restrictions on their freedoms be lifted, despite Taliban crackdowns on protests that have seen activists detained. Their courage is remarkable and inspiring, and the least we can do is show our solidarity like we are doing today. The least we can do is our bit. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I would like to just talk about two friends of mine who have done their bit and made a difference for the women of Afghanistan. My previous English teacher, Sam Mort, was head of communications for UNICEF in Afghanistan in 2021. You may have seen her on the BBC World Service. Her courage reporting from that place, telling all of us about what was going on, was inspirational. And her skills also as a diplomat in order to protect women and girls in Afghanistan during her time there is something I find personally extremely inspirational, and I know others do too. And also my friend Lucy Blake, a lawyer who worked on a pro bono basis to fight for a female Afghan judge who cannot be disclosed due to security concerns to come to the UK. And she won that battle for the judge she represented in the summer of this year. These are two examples of women from our part of the world doing their bit. Women supporting women. Linda Norgrove also. We remember her and her foundation, and that's still doing great work today. So in the face of the brutality of the Taliban in the face of such egregious violations of international human rights, we may feel that we have very little influence, but we all must do our bit. And by doing our bit, whether it's speaking in Parliament or the significant examples I've highlighted today of people in our communities from our country making an impact, if we all do our bit, then perhaps there can be a brighter future for the women and girls of Afghanistan. In fact, we must believe that and work towards it.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. I now invite Angus Robertson to respond to the debate. Cabinet Secretary, around 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And to fellow members, thank you all for your passionate words, and thank you especially to Michelle Thompson for bringing this debate to the Chamber. The Scottish Government is committed to promoting democracy, human rights and the rule of law, both at home and abroad, recognising Scotland's role as a good global citizen. Through dialogue, we seek to promote international human rights standards, and debates such as these are vital in that aim. We've shown that this Parliament speaks with one voice in recognising the truly horrific situation faced by women in Afghanistan, and I'd like to acknowledge the powerful contributions from all sides of Scotland's Parliament today, from Michelle Thompson, from Kenneth Gibson, Pam Gosal, Ruth Maguire, Martin Whitfield and Ben McPherson. Since retaking control of Afghanistan in 2021, the Taliban has created the world's most serious women's rights crisis. Scottish Government condemns in the strongest terms the Taliban's systematic violation of the rights of women and girls, particularly relating to education, to employment, to freedom of speech and movement, to right to liberty and life, and also to political participation. Where we can, the Scottish Government has sought to help people in Afghanistan. In 2021, the country experienced unprecedented levels of hunger and malnutrition due to the combined effects of economic collapse through continuing conflict and the worst drought in living memory, as well as COVID-19. The Scottish Government provided £600,000 of support, including targeted mental health and psychosocial support for mothers and children, and food packages for pregnant and breastfeeding women and malnourished children. In November 2023, we also provided £250,000 to support those left without shelter and other essentials following several large earthquakes. UN Security Council Resolution 1325 recognises the important role of women in the prevention and the resolution of conflicts, stressing the importance of equal participation in efforts to maintain and promote peace and to promote security. And since 2016, the Scottish Government has funded the Women in Conflict Fellowship to support the implementation of this resolution. And to date, we have supported 378 fellows from over 30 countries, including 8 outstanding female activists from Afghanistan. Scottish Government also funds the Scottish Human Rights Defender Fellowship Programme, which offers human rights defenders working in difficult conditions respite and opportunities to undertake research and develop skills and build networks during a 3 to 6 month visit to Scotland. Scotland remains committed to playing our part in welcoming and supporting people fleeing Afghanistan. Officials continue to work with partners to provide people with the safety and the security that they need to rebuild their lives. In line with the key principle of the new Scots refugee integration strategy, local authorities are working to support integration from day one of arrival here in Scotland. We're committed to delivering a feminist approach in all of our international work, putting the rights of women, girls and marginalised groups at the heart of our international activities. And one way that we deliver on this is through our international development work. While also implementing equality-focused programmes, we're working to ensure equality is embedded across all of our international development work, including our inclusive education programme. This promotes fairness and human rights for all, prioritising access to education for women and girls. And this has been inspired by Malala Yousafzai, the very courageous campaign for better education for girls, after she was shot for opposing Taliban restrictions. We set up a scholarship scheme in Pakistan for women and have continued to invest in this important programme. Unfortunately, women and children continue to suffer disproportionately in conflict. Of the 35,000 reported deaths in Gaza, the majority are known to be women and children. The situation for women in Afghanistan is truly dire, and I urge the United Kingdom government to do more to work with international partners to address the dreadful humanitarian and human rights situation that we've been considering today. We know that women and girls are disproportionately affected by crises around the world, whether climate change, war, or pandemics. And amid concerning global trends, seeing a rollback on the rights of women and girls, we must remain committed to achieving gender equality at home in Scotland, as well as engaging internationally as a good global citizen, to advocate for the advancement of these rights for all women and all girls globally. Nowhere is advocacy, global cooperation and coordinated action to protect women more necessary than in Afghanistan today. And we pledge to continue our work, and I'm pleased to note that it has support from all corners of the chamber, and it will continue to do so. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.